Good morning, Temple of Praise. Does it feel good to be in the house of the Lord this morning?
Yeah.
You know, I was talking to Mr. Charlie this morning, and I was telling him, I said, we've made it through another week. But you know, right about that time, he put his hand on me, and he kind of brought like a calmness over my spirit. I don't think he knew, but at that time, like, I had like a lot of stuff going on. And a lot of things I was just thinking about, like, as I was still prepping to come up here for this morning, I was just thinking about the week, you know, and I work as a consultant for this company, and I'm watching everybody in there. It's month-end close, actually quarter-end close. And they're like, I mean, they're like just losing it. I'm watching people, like they get an email and they start crying because like they just totally stressed out. And I'm like, and I felt like, and I was telling myself, I felt like all week, I didn't really feel like I did any work. I just felt like I was just there to like constantly like encourage and to try to like keep people like, as I would put it, just sane. But then as I was talking to him, I realized, as Christians, that's what we're supposed to do. Amen. When everything looks bleak, it's all because they're thinking it's bleak because they don't have anything to turn to. They don't have any hope. But with us, we know we have God on our side.
Amen.
As long as we have Jesus with us, there isn't anything we can't get through.
Amen.
I was talking to a couple of people we know about what happened in Florida. And they were kind of worked up and it was like, you know, why? And it's like, look, we all know that things are going to happen. It's up to us as Christians to unite together to show the world that there is another way. You don't have to go out and do some of the craziness you see on the news. I watch a lot of political shows, and I was watching one, and the person started talking about what they saw saw for 2017 was that there was no way for anybody to know what was true. So at that point, I kind of turned around and I was like, no, I'm sorry. I know exactly. I know exactly what truth is. And we all have it right here. This is never going to change. Always going to be the same. It's been the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. We have the truth. So when they sit on the news and say, oh, well, we can't tell what's the truth, that's because they haven't gotten in their word. They don't know Jesus. So it's up to each and every one of us to go out and tell the world about Jesus Christ. So dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, Lord. First, Lord, just saying thank you. Lord God, we truly thank you, Lord God, for just bringing us through another week. Lord God, we thank you, Lord God, for one more opportunity to come together corporately and just praise and worship your name, Father God. Lord God, I ask this morning you would anoint the praise and worship team. Lord God, we ask that you would anoint the equipment, Lord God, that those who are logged in on the internet will be able to enjoy service, Father God, without any interruptions, Father God. Lord God, we ask, Lord God, when your word goes forth, Father God, that it would touch, heal, and most of all, Lord God, bring some soul back into your family, Father God. Lord God, we ask, Lord God, you continue to give us the words, Father God, to speak to a dying world. Right now, Father God, we ask that you would just have your way this morning. Again, we thank you and we love you in Jesus' name. And everyone says, amen.
Are y'all ready to worship this morning? Come on and stand to your feet. And let's give God our best praise today. Amen.
Through you, I can do anything. I can do all things, 'cause it's you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible. Through you, blind eyes are open. Strongholds are broken. I am living by faith. Nothing is impossible. I you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible.
Sing, I believe. I want you to catch that fire. I want you to catch that promise. I want you to catch that faith that you're supposed to have mustered up within you. I believe. I believe. I believe. Whatever prayer that you're believing for, whatever financial breakthrough you're asking for, I believe. Whatever healing you're asking for, I believe. Whatever relationship you need fixed, I believe. Whoever you're praying for salvation and healing, deliverance, addiction to be broken, chains to be gone, to be delivered, I believe. Can you say that with me this morning? I believe. Come on, let me hear you say it again. I believe. Oh, say it with a little bit more strength. I believe. Now I want everyone in here, if you have a prayer request that you've been praying for, close your eyes and lift your hands. Just close your eyes and lift your hands with me. And let's just say this together. I believe. I believe. I believe in you, Lord. We believe in you, God. We believe. We stand on your word. And we believe. We believe that blind eyes are going to be opened. We believe that lost souls are going to come to you. We believe that the sick are going to be healed. We believe that the dead will rise, God, that you're going to do great and mighty things. One more time, church, say it. I believe. Come on and let's sing it. Let me hear ya.
I believe in you.
Oh, come on and tell that mountain to move. I believe.
I believe. I believe in you.
A little bit stronger.
I believe. I believe.
Yeah.
I believe. I believe in you.
Say it again.
I believe. I believe. I believe. I believe in you. I believe. I believe.
Yes, I do.
I believe in you. I believe, I believe. I believe, I believe.
Come on and sing it.
Through you, I can do anything. I can do all things. Cause it's you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible. Through you, blind eyes are open. Strongholds are broken. I am living by faith.
Nothing,
nothing is impossible.
You know why we can get excited with our faith? Why we can get a little bit more boisterous with our worship? Because we call and we serve a God named Jesus Christ, who has conquered death, who has conquered the grave, and we can come before him with our requests and with our needs in Jesus' name. Amen.
shaken. We will not be moved. Jesus, you are here. Carrying our burdens, covering our shame. He has overcome, yes, he has overcome. We will not be shaken.
Shout it out, God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up
shout it out.
Come on, sing it
shout
again.
It out. God is fighting for us, pushing back the darkness, lighting up the kingdom that cannot be shaken. In the name of Jesus, the enemy's defeated. And we will shout it out. I will live, I will not die. The resurrection power of Christ alive in me, and I am free in Jesus' name.
Jesus, in the name of Jesus, sickness, you have no power. In the name of Jesus, addiction, you have no power. In the name of Jesus, depression, you have no foothold. You are defeated. It has been conquered in the name of Jesus.
It's good to know that God is fighting for us. Amen. Can you put your hands together again this morning? Hallelujah. The song we'd like to sing this morning talks about worshiping in spirit and in truth. I'd like to read from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4 and 5. It says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy might." Worshiping God requires all our heart. Amen. How many of you want to give Him your heart this morning? And worship Him in truth means we must really know Him. Let's really draw close into our God this morning. Worship Him in spirit and truth. Let's sing it.
We worship you in the truth.
Yes, Lord.
We worship you in the spirit. That's what I'm going to do.
Come on, let me hear every man. Lift your voice, man.
We worship you.
Oh, come on and lead us into the presence today.
The Spirit.
Oh, we worship you, Lord.
We worship you in the truth. We worship you in the Spirit. That's what I want.
Lift your hands and worship Him this morning. Come on.
We worship you in the Spirit.
We worship you, Lord God.
We worship you in the truth.
We worship you,
Lord. We worship you in the Spirit.
Into the
Holy of Holies. That's where I want to be. Into the Holy of Holies.
We worship you in the Spirit.
Let's declare he's magnificent, he's wonderful, mighty God, our Savior. Magnificent God, magnificent Lord, Lord, we Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. Magnificent God. Oh, magnificent God. Magnificent Lord, oh Lord, looking for true worshipers. How many of you want to be a true worshiper of God this morning? Come on, lift your hands with me. Let's sing it. Hallelujah.
Magnificent
Lord. Magnificent.
Lord, we worship you. Magnificent God,
magnificent God,
oh, magnificent Lord,
magnificent Lord.
Tells us very clearly that if we fail to pray or intercede for someone, then the blood of that person will be on our hands. And I was just sitting here thinking, Father, how many people have I failed to intercede for that I should have interceded for? Cleanse my hands, Lord. Cleanse my hands. And so as we bring our prayer petitions up here this morning, we're going to ask God to cleanse our hands, hallelujah, that nothing will be held to our account that we failed to pray or intercede for someone else. Father God, you are a magnificent God. Father, we know that you fight our battles for us. We know, oh God, that you are our healer, our Savior. We know, oh God, that you break strongholds. We know all these things, Father. But Lord, we don't want to take it for granted, because we want to acknowledge, oh God, who you are and how awesome you are. And we want to be obedient to your word and pray as you have called us to pray. Father God, as these prayer petitions are being brought up to these altars this morning, quicken to our spirit, quicken to our hearts who we should have prayed for and who we failed to pray for, oh God. Oh God, that our hands would be clean. For you say, who can ascend unto you but those that have a pure heart and clean hands? Lord, I want clean hands this morning so that my prayers are not hindered, so that my worship is received, so that you can be lifted up and glorified. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for clean hands. I thank you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. And we pray, Father, for all of the petitions that are coming forward right now. Oh God, we pray, Father, for our children. We pray for our children's church workers, Father, that they would never feel that they are babysitting, or they would never feel that they are not appreciated. Because, oh God, our children are our future. They're our hearts. They're our future. We pray, oh God, for our youth. Oh God, for we lose so many. We lose so many of our children as they go through junior high and high school and into college. But, oh God, we pray, oh God, that we set that foundation, oh God, that our youth serve you, and that our youth hunger for you, and that our youth want to serve you. Oh, Jesus, we pray for our homes. Oh, God, turn the hearts of the husbands to the wives and the hearts of the wives to the husbands. And for those single-parent households, oh, God, Father, let them know that you are right there with them, Father, leading them and guiding them, oh, God. Father, in the rough, rough place of being a single parent, oh, God, I thank you, Lord, for all that you do. We pray, oh, God, for our churches. Pray for our pastors and our men of God. Oh, God, the crime rate in San Antonio has gone up 60% over last year. Father, we need the Ten Commandments back in the schools. We need thou shalt not kill. We need, oh God, our children to be raised up in your word, oh God, that they would learn to respect one another and respect authority and respect each other's property. Oh, Father God, I thank you, oh Lord. I thank you, Lord, that the churches would do the job they're supposed to do, that your people would do the job that they're supposed to do. I thank you for those that get involved in community and in school boards. I thank you, oh God, for they're the salt and the light. Father, we uphold them, oh God, for holy boldness, oh God, that they would not compromise your word, but make strong stands, oh God. For we need it, oh God. We need revival in our land. We pray for our nation, oh God. We pray, oh God, for our nation. Oh, Jesus, again, we need a return to your word. We need a return to your principles. We need a return to you, my Lord God. I thank you, Lord. Magnificent God, forgive us when we fail to pray. Forgive us, Father. I thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord. I thank you for Temple of Praise. I thank you for Pastor Crain and Pastor Perez. I thank you for me. I thank you for all of the workers here, oh God. Father, that daily, oh God, want to bring forth your word and build your kingdom and let your word prevail, hallelujah. I thank you for Christine and the musicians and the singers, oh God, diligent, oh God, to sing and preach your word through song. I thank you, Father, for all that are committed, our ushers, oh God. Oh, Jesus, our elders, oh God, our teachers, oh God. Oh, Jesus, cleanse our hands, oh God. Cleanse our hands and forgive us for not praying when you've called us to pray. We commit all of this to you now. We commit all of these prayer petitions. Father, you know the needs. You're able to heal. You're able to save. You're able to break strongholds, oh God. You're able, oh God, to meet financial needs. Open the doors to those people that are looking for jobs, oh God. Meet the need, Jehovah Jireh. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray and we give it all to you now. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen, amen. So be it, according to your words, so be it. Hallelujah. Now, before you sit down, go and greet somebody you don't know. You already greeted those around you here by you in the front rows. But go and greet someone and tell them that you're so glad that they're here. Hallelujah.
You are here. If you're wondering if you've noticed that why our greeting time is getting longer and longer, it's because no matter how many memos, how many emails, how many text messages I send my lovely father, he's still going to walk the whole church instead of come pick up the offering. But today we're going to pick up this morning's tithes and love offerings. Amen. That's your job, mister. Yes. Modern technology, it's a help, huh?
Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. David said, I'd rather be one day just in the house of the Lord than 1,000 days anywhere else doing whatever. It is better to be in the house of the Lord. And I'm glad that you're here. My wife was just praying a few moments ago, interceding. And before we go any further, I want us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, the peace of Israel. Just a few hours ago, an ISIS person drove a truck into a place, into a corner where the street corner where there were a lot of people waiting to cross the street, and hit a whole bunch of people. Four were dead and about 15 are hurt. And it's just a continual thing. And we just need to pray. Father, we just come before you. You tell us to pray for the peace of Jerusalem, Father, to pray for Israel and to bless Israel. We have your promise that those of us that would pray for Israel, Father, would be blessed. And you also say that those that would curse Israel would be cursed. We've seen those curses come to pass, Father, and we see the blessings as well. And we seek your blessings continually, Father. Lord God, we know that not everyone wants to hurt Israel, but many do. And we just want to pray, Father, according to your word, and ask you to bless Israel, Father, and protect it, Father. We thank you for that right now. Father, we pray for the children, Father, who are being indoctrinated into hatred and violence. Lord God, as soon as the news was broadcast in Palestine, women and men were handing out candy to the children, celebrating the killing of those people in Jerusalem. Those children do not know any better, Father. They just know what they're being indoctrinated. We pray for those men, Father, for those women. We ask you to bless them, Father. We ask you to touch them, Father, to convert them to you. We pray for those children, Father. We thank you, Lord God. It is such a difficult time, but we know that what we sang a moment ago, that you prevail above all things and that you remove the darkness, we continue to believe that we are the light and we shall be the light. And we thank you for it in Jesus' name. And we now bless this offering, Father, and tithes. In Jesus' name, amen. Go ahead, brother. Praise the Lord.
Well, Happy New Year, church. Happy New Year. Good morning and welcome to Top Church. Yes, we are so glad to have you with us today, have you worshiping here. I know and I am believing that God is going to lavish himself upon us this year. Amen. Together, as we together come together to build and prosper this ministry. Amen. If you are here for the first time, can you raise your hand? We'd like to offer you a Connect card, and we want to welcome you. We thank you for coming and visiting. We ask that you would drop it in the offering basket, or you can take it back there to the Connect Center. Well, the new year is upon us. It's 2017. So to kick things off, you know what time it is, right? That's not a lot of strong amen in. It's time for our 21-day fast. Yay! I know. It officially begins tonight at 6 p.m. and it's going to go on through January 29th, excuse me. Yes, 21 days is a long time. Yes, this is a difficult thing to do. And yes, there will be a million excuses, some valid, why you can't start it and why you can't finish it. But let me tell you, the biggest yes of all is the biggest yes is your unanswered prayers are worth it. They're worth it. The mountains that you need moved in your life, they're worth it. Those souls that you're praying and fasting to get saved and to come back into the house of the Lord, they're worth it. That the disease that you need gone from your body, it's worth it. The marriage that you need saved, it's worth it. Your joy and your peace, I need a little bit more than two of you to get excited about that. It's worth it. It's worth it. So let's pray and fast together and see what God has in store for this ministry. And let's get all that we have. Amen? So we're going to start this prayer and fasting today. Remember, in the long scheme of things, it's only 21 days. All right? There are different types of fasting. We do ask you to visit the Connect Center after service. We have some papers that we're going to pass out, some recipes to help you. And we've even have a Facebook page that was created to help even further. We want you to be able to have that exchange, to get encouragement, to exchange recipes, to ask questions, to get of us praying together. So if you are interested in joining this Facebook page, there is a list back there at the Connect Center. Give us your name, your Facebook name, whatever your Facebook name is, your phone number. We're going to add you to that page. And together, we're going to do this 21-day fast. Amen? And we're going to make it, and we're going to see the awesome results that God has in store for us. So I cannot express enough the spiritual importance of this fast. Take it very seriously. Amen? And remember, you are not alone. Don't forget to join us online for prayer in the mornings while you're getting ready, while you're driving to work from 6:30 to 7:30. It's a great way to start your day to get boosted. Amen? God bless you, your family, and let's continue on in his presence. Help me welcome today to the stage as we prepare for the word, Pastor Crain.
Amen. I'm glad that you're here this morning. I'm glad that I'm here this morning. Would you stand with me as we go before the Lord and read his word? Turn your Bibles to the book of Luke, chapter 6. Luke, chapter 6. I'm not making an indictment against anybody, but I'm just looking across the crowd and I'm telling you, you could do to fast. I'm not pointing you out specifically. I'm just saying, you know, a few days fasting ain't going to hurt many people that I'm looking at right now. That's all I'm going to say. And I'm talking to me as well. When I was walking up them stairs just right now, I was like, Lord Jesus, I need to fast a little bit. I'll talk about the fast as we go on in today's message, but I want to get right to God's word. I believe that this is a vital importance to get you and to get us and to get our church to where we want to be. Say amen to that. Amen. Praise the Lord. Luke chapter 6, I'm going to start with verse 7, and we'll read large chunks because I don't know how much you've read your word this week, and I want you to be familiar with the story that we'll be talking about. Luke chapter 6, verse 7, say amen when you're there. Amen. The Bible says, and he called to himself, and Jesus called to himself the 12. And he began to send them forth by two, and he gave them power over unclean spirits. And he commanded them. Which book did I say? Luke. You should have known what I meant was Mark. You know, just, I heard a lot of people talking. You better be saying, be that vocal when you hear God speak to you this morning. Amen. Mark chapter 6. Oh, you know what? I have it wrong in my notes. That's why. Mark chapter 6. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. What a wonderful song service we've had. Amen. Praise the Lord. The presence of the Lord is in this place. What church should I go to? Where should I make my home? Where the presence of God is. Amen. Are you finally right? I know I was right the whole time. Are you guys finally right? Mark chapter 6, verse 7. And Jesus called unto him the 12, and he began to send them forth by two and two, and he gave them power over unclean spirits. And he commanded them that they should take nothing for their journey except a staff only, no scrip, no bread, no money in their purse, but only the sandals that were on their feet. And he said to them, in what place soever that you enter into a house, there abide till you depart from that place. And whoever shall not receive you nor hear you when you depart from there, shake off the dust from underneath your feet as a testimony against him. Verily I say unto you, it will be more tolerable for Sodom and Gomorrah in that day, in the day of judgment for that city. And they went out and they preached that men should repent. And they cast out many devils and anointed with oil many that were sick, and they healed them. Somebody say, praise the Lord. Skip down to verse 30. After this ministry trip, we pick up the story. And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus and told him all the things, both what they had done and what they had taught. And Jesus said to them, come yourselves and let's go into a desert place and rest for a while. If you don't mind writing in your Bibles, I want you to underline that word desert. Come and apart into a desert place and rest for a while, for there were many coming and going, and they had no leisure, not even to eat. And they departed into a desert place by ship privately. And the people saw them departing, and many knew him, and they ran afoot there of all the cities, and they got there before them, before they came, and they came together unto him. And Jesus, when he came out, saw the people, and he had compassion towards them, because they were as a sheep, not having a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. And when the day was now far spent, his disciples came unto him, and they said, this is a desert place, and now the time is far past. Send them away, that they may go into the country round about and into the villages and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. And Jesus answered and said, why don't you give them something to eat? And they said, shall we go and buy $200 worth of bread and give them to eat? And he said, how many loaves do you have? Go and see. And when they knew, they said, 5 and 2 fishes. I'm going to stop here. And he commanded them to make them sit down by companies upon the green grass. Father, we just thank you so much for this day. We thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for who you are. And right now, in the name of your son, Jesus Christ, this is a word for today and for the hearers that are here. And I declare that we are going to be transformed by your power, by your word, and that we are going to deal with our deserts and see you do great things. In Jesus' name, amen. Before you sit down, place your left hand over your heart. Extend your right hand towards me. Let's pray this prayer together. Say, dear Jesus, right now, I declare that my heart is good ground, and I receive God's word today with joy, and it will produce maximum fruit in Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. Give the Lord a hand clap before you sit down. You may be seated. In everything that Jesus did and everything that Jesus does, there are several things going on at the same time. There is the practical story of what he was doing. There is the prophetic message of what he did. And of course, there is the principle of what was going on. And what I want to talk to you this morning about is the principle of what Jesus was doing. Jesus was dealing with deserts. Jesus was dealing with deserts. What was Jesus dealing with? Deserts are an important geographical place, and they're a common theme in the scripture. You and I don't have this kind of experience because we don't live next to a desert. We know the heat of a desert in July and August, but we don't live next to a desert. When we think desert, we think in terms of a place that's hot and a place that's arid. When Jesus and when the Bible is talking about desert, it's talking about a place that's lifeless. It's a place that is deserted. It's a place that is alone. It's a place where no one, not only can no one live there, but no one can dwell there or stay there because there is not an environment conducive to support life. There's no river to draw from. There's no animals to kill and eat. There's it's a desert alone place. And if you look at scripture, deserts are a common geographical destination that God's people seem to always be in. I mean, if we start with Abraham, in fact, let me even go back a little further. Right after the flood, men began to dwell in deserts. Follow me here. And the thing is men begin, instead of being in one place where God planted individuals in a garden, in a place where they could dwell, they began to be nomadic, traveling around from one place to another place. In fact, one of the greatest promises that God gave Abram, before he even promised him a son, he promised him a land to dwell in. It's not my will that you go from place to place to place, from thing to thing to thing. Always needful, always searching, always looking, looking for the next place of provision. I want to settle you somewhere, and I want to bless you. So the first thing that Abram is told is, I want you to leave your father's house, and I will give you a land to dwell in. Get out of this desert and come to a place that I've promised you. It's an incredible analogy that's so practically seen. Israel is literally an oasis, the physical land surrounded by thousands of square miles of desert. It's this picture that God is showing. And people that are desert dwellers are always despised by everybody else. In the scripture, and even today, you have nomadic peoples that go around, the Bedouins. And why they're despised is they're a large group that bring nothing except need to the table. When a large group shows up in your city in the biblical days, there's only so much food, so much water, so much things to give out, and now this large group is going to be taking our resources. They were individuals that roamed from one place to another. And that's why one of the reasons that people were horrified at God's people. Here's this large group of 1.5 million people that can't seem to get through the desert. And they're showing up at different places. And there's just this horrible thing, getting from one place to another, never coming to the promise. And in Jesus' day, he did things that dealt with things that offended him, not as Jesus, but as Jesus, the man on earth, but Jesus, the everlasting Word of God. Let me give an example of this. In the last couple of weeks of Jesus' life, you may remember the story where Jesus is going from Bethany back into Jerusalem. Shake your heads. Just shake your heads like these names mean something to you. And so he's coming and he sees this fig tree and it has flowers. And from a distance, it looks like it has figs. And Jesus gets up to the fig tree and it has nothing. It's just flowers. And Jesus said, I curse this fig tree, which is kind of upsetting. If you're one of the disciples, it's like, easy there. You know, geez, we'll get some tacos on the way in. Just hold on. And if you remember the story, they go into, they minister, and they do what they do in Jerusalem. They come back, and the tree is not only, it's withered, it has been uprooted, and it's on the ground like it's been dead for years. And the disciples, if I'm one of the disciples, I'm like, dang, you got upset at this tree for sure, right? Man, what did this thing do against you? Because I don't want you to do that. Obviously, there was a lesson here. Let me just give it to you. It's just a parenthesis to show you what Jesus was doing. The fig tree was symbolic of the false self. You remember that the fig tree was what Adam and Eve at the beginning covered themselves with when they were hiding from the presence of God. So this thing was more symbolic. It was symbolizing something that God's people are always dealing with, and Jesus immediately cursed it. Those were lessons that no doubt I would have missed them too, but the disciples got them as they looked back and they wrote their books, and these were things that they picked up later. And here they're picking this up because they say we were called into the three times in one story. When something is given to you three times in one story, what they're telling you is, we missed this while we were in it, but you better dig and you better get it. First of all, this is a weird thing. This is strange. It's odd. If I'm one of the disciples, I've just gone on my first ministry trip. We're having a meeting. We're having staff meeting, and we're having praise the Lord's, and we've been living by faith for the last few weeks, and we're saying all of these things that we've done, and the reports are awesome. We delivered people out of the enemy's hands. Praise the Lord. We delivered people. We laid hands on them and anointed them with oil, and they got healed. This was an incredible thing. Man, we can't believe the success we've had. And Jesus said, this is amazing. You know what we need to do? Let's go on a little vacation. Let's take a weekend off, no ministry, no nothing, and let's just relax. Does that sound like a good idea? Everybody wanted to say Mark instead of Luke, but now everybody's deaf. Does that sound like a good idea? Yes. I would say that. Jesus wants to take me on vacation. Yes. And then he says, let's go to a desert. Hold up, man. I mean, when I think of vacation and relaxing and go and chill out for a couple days, I'm not thinking desert. Now, how do I know that this offended him? Because look at the way the book is written. Verse 32, and they departed into a desert place by ship privately. Jesus said, let's go to the desert. And the person writing said, he's saying this. Peter is talking to Mark, who's writing this book, and he's saying, and that's exactly what we did. We went to a desert place. We all thought we were going to the Hilton, Hill Country. But no, we didn't go there. We went to a desert place. So you're already in a wrong state of mind. But if God is doing this, if Christ is doing this, there's got to be a reason for it. God's people are always tied to deserts. From the first annals of Scripture, just one desert after another. And if you really read it, they only got to dwell in the land, not even 2%. 2%. If you're looking at time, from the time God promised in the land to Abraham to the land that they've been in, they've only dwelt in it, actually dwelt in their land. Actually, listen to that. I'm thinking about Old Testament only. If you add the New Testament, less than 1% of the time, they've never dwelt in the land of promise. They've dwelt in one desert after another. One place after another. One desert after another. And the thing is that as we're wandering around, what Jesus was doing was trying to get these individuals to not only see it, but to get delivered from it. Because our relationships can move into deserts. They start off passionately, you start off in love, you start off gracious, you start off with all of God's promise, but somehow a few years later, you're in a desert place. Your finances can be in deserts. Everything you probably make more money than your parents ever made. And still you got to call them for loans and help and pay this and pay that. Because our finances get in deserts. Our emotions get in deserts. And what I mean by that specifically is they get into a place where the provision is scarce, where God seems to have left us, and here's the kicker, where we don't ever seem to leave from. It's just one desert after another. And follow me here, because say this out loud with me. Say, God loves me so much. You know, the thing about God is he loves you so much. He can't leave you in the desert by yourself. So God deals with you in your desert. I mean, if you look at the scripture, let's be honest, the greatest miracles that God ever did started in the desert. I mean, the parting of the Red Sea happened in the desert. The manna from heaven happened in the desert. I mean, look at how important this is. Jesus, when he went to get tempted, the Bible says God led him to a desert. John the Baptist came from the desert. So this thing is always prevalent in God's people. And Jesus is saying, okay, you've done your first ministry trip. That's fantastic. But now we're going to go and deal with the desert. In dealing with the desert, you have to understand, you have to be careful of this. I just want to give you another parenthesis. You have to be careful that you don't become somebody's desert. What I mean by that is this, is there are people that will travel around and around, and then they stop at you, and they want to drain your resources. They want to drain your resources. And we, especially because we're loving individuals, we want to give people those things. But at some stage, you have to understand this, that people will drain you, and then once you've given all you've given to them, they're just going to go to somebody else and do the exact same thing. How come? Because I'm used to living in the desert. And for God to really move, we have to deal with this desert issue. These guys are already in a bad mood, and it's just funny how it goes. If you ever are grumpy and mad and you know, you've got a little attitude going on, what the Lord does, I've seen, not in my life, but in your life, he sends more problems to you. When you're in a bad attitude, that's when God says, okay, you got a bad attitude, let me give you some other things to really get you upset. So here the disciples are, they're not real thrilled about let's go to the desert, and then Jesus gets to the thing, and somehow the people all get there, and what they're wanting to hear is, okay, let's move these people around so we can go and deal with me. It's me time. More people need to amen than that. I need me time. So Jesus, here's the thing, the disciples don't write down what Jesus taught, although they said he taught all day. And then he went far into the day. That means they weren't paying attention. That means they were clock watching. Are you joking me? More? Point 44 already. Jesus stops and heals people. Jesus is talking. The people are there. And he's going on and on and on and on. And when he's gone on some more, somehow he kicks it into another gear and goes into some more. Now, the people were excited. The God's people, however, the sinners said more, more, more. God's people started saying, the disciples said, stop, stop, stop. Enough already. The playoffs are on. We're already at the Super Bowl. When you started, it was week one. Doesn't say it. I just know how this works because I've been in ministry all my life. The guy's going forever. Tell him something. What do you want me to tell him? I mean, every time we go up there, someone's getting healed, someone's doing blind. What do you want me? I mean, cut it already. Remember, this is supposed to be our vacation. What do you want me to tell him? I'm starving to death. How about that? I'm about to drop dead. We've been here all day. Please, can you give me a happy meal, something? Well, he's never going to go for that. Well, tell him the people are hungry. There you go. Tell them let's dismiss so the people can go get food. That's a good idea, he says. That's going to work. That's going to work. That's going to work. Now, here's the thing. I hope you get this, because it was something that Jesus immediately taught people after he used them. After you get used by God, you can't help but think you're somewhat a little bit special. You can't help that. There's no need to try to not think that, because you can't help it. There's a way to deal with it that I'll show you in a minute, but you can't help it. So they get used by God, and they're excited, and now they're feeling like something. They're feeling like they have something to offer. I mean, you weren't even around, Lord. I went up to that devil and faced him down and told him what to do. I'm the one that healed this person and that person and the other. That was their testimony, because that's what they just said. That is a way, when you begin to say, this is what I did and this is how I did it, that is a direct path into a desert. When you begin to be self-sufficient, the Lord loves to put his people into deserts and say, oh, you think you know how? You think you can make this better? You think your ways are better than my ways? You think your thing is better and your plan is better than my plan? I'm just going to show you something. So now they have the need. One of the disciples go and say, Geez, hold on real quick before you get to point 47. Hold on. Guys, we're excited. Lord, these people are going to starve to death. You've been going for like 9.5 hours. Okay, we get it. Okay, but the live stream people, the internet already broke. It's done. All right, electricity's about to get turned up. We got to send these people away. They're so hungry. We need to go ahead and turn them loose. And Jesus said something that as I read it from the perspective of the disciple, it would have knocked me on my behind. This is what Jesus says. Oh, the people are hungry? Well, go ahead and give them something to eat. What? And what he was dealing with was not just the situation, but he wanted to keep them from going to the desert. Follow me here. You did a couple of good things, right? You did a couple of good things. Well, and you think you have all the answers? Well, why don't you go ahead and provide some food for these people? Go ahead. Show me what you got. Hey, I'm hungry too. Let's just be real. I've been up here ministering. That's a great idea. Why don't we go ahead and get some food? Why don't you go ahead and feed everybody? That was the stupidest thing you ever said in me. Are you kidding me? You know what he told me? What did he tell you? He told us to feed everybody. With what? I'm not going back up there again and talking. No way. Can you imagine how ridiculous that sounds? The scripture says, as we find later on in the story, which is later on, thus emphasizing the beginning, that there was at least 5,000 men, which supposes each one of them had a wife and a couple of kids, and if they were like the Cranes, that could have been a 50,000 large crowd. What I'm getting to is this. When Jesus said, go ahead and give them something to eat, they themselves knew, we have nothing to give. We have nothing to give. That realization, I have nothing to give, is what will keep you out of the desert. When you begin to realize, I've got nothing to give. I've got nothing to do. I've got nothing to give. I've got no gift. I've got nothing that can really make a significant impact. If I am not empowered by you behind me, I can do nothing. Jesus was emphasizing, you need to make a quick transition. Before you get yourself into the desert, you need to transition out of you thinking, and you better transition into me thinking. When you're with me, you can do everything. Without me, go ahead and try to feed these people. And what Jesus did not offer was a solution. He only offered a command. Go ahead and feed them. Goes back, and of course you know the story. Let me move on a little bit. We're going to pick the story up in verse 34. And Jesus, when he came out, saw the people and was moved with compassion towards them because they were as sheep not having a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things. And as he began to teach many things, remember, he was not just teaching them many things. He was teaching the people with him many things. He taught the people that was listening through the message he was preaching. He taught the people that were with him through the actions he was doing. So each one picked up on the message and the teaching that was being taught. The first thing is this. To not end up in a desert, you have to learn this. If you're going to write something down, write this down. I am nothing without Christ. All I am without Christ is another individual dwelling in a desert waiting for somebody to give me something. I am nothing without Christ. I know some of you think you're something, Oh, everybody look at me. Don't get sleepy right now. I know that a lot of you think you've got things going on. You've got ideas. You've got a way to do things. You've got a map of your life. You've got plans. You believe you have skills. I'm not saying that you're not without those things. I'm saying those things without Christ amount to nothing. They amount to nothing. If you get that revelation, you'll never be in a desert. Because the people that end up in a desert are always the individuals that are pointing their fingers at God and always struggling with whose plan is best until God says, okay, if you want to stay here, stay here. Isn't that what God has done repeatedly in the scriptures? That his people are always rebelling against him, living in a desert until he says, finally, if this is what you want, go ahead and stay here. I don't want to be in the desert in 2017. I don't want this church to be in the desert in 2017. I don't want your relationships to be in the desert anymore. I don't want my money to be in the desert anymore. I don't want my family to be in the desert anymore. I want to do what I want to be in the place where Christ is. And if the first step of that is realizing without Christ, I'm nothing. I like this next part. Give him something to eat. They go back and they figure out, Lord, this is what we got. We got a Fred's fish fry. Happy meal. It's a two-piece. Right? Not even the family. It's the two-piece. It was a kid. Plus, he got some extra rolls. That's what we got to work with. That doesn't seem like a significant step, but Jesus was teaching them something that they learned and put in practice the remainder of their life. Nothing can be blessed until it's given to the Lord. I can't seem to find my husband or my wife. You haven't given your morality and your sexual self to God yet, have you? I can't seem to find happiness and my money doesn't ever seem to go. You can't seem to ever tithe on a consistent basis. I'm always getting distracted from one thing or the other thing. What have you brought God besides a request? What have you brought him? What have you presented to him? Because it's not what you have, it's the fact that you bring it to him. Somebody say amen. It's the fact, Lord, I want this. I want to get out of the desert, but I'm not going to work. I'm not going to give you anything to work with. All I'm going to give you is one problem and one issue, listen to me, and one prayer after another. Your prayers aren't being answered because you're not offering anything with them. Don't come to God empty-handed. What can you give me to work with here? It's better to have individuals weeping at the altar saying, God, my life is messed up. I've committed adultery. I've got a disease. I've got sickness. I'm failing. I'm giving it all to you. Do you know in heaven, although everybody may be pointing against you and hell may be against you, in heaven what they're saying is finally we can step in and get him and get her out of the desert and bring her to a place of blessing. What is it going to take to get you to give something to God? Now look at this. This order. Look at the person next to you, say order. Order is important. If I can put it to you this way, this is one of the reasons that we emphasize this fast. Because there's an order to things that God does. And the fast, in one sense, is allowing myself to be put in a desert. By fasting, this is what you can do. Let me just give you an explain. You know, as we talk about this, we're not talking about don't eat or don't drink water for 21 days. And don't try that, because most people try something like, I'm going to do this. They have all these thoughts, and then by tomorrow, like at 2 o'clock, I can't do it. I'm dying. You know, you go eat a Whataburger, and you just give up about before you even really get hungry. What a 21-day, what we call a Daniel fast is where we give up everything basically besides fruits and vegetables. You know those things you never eat? And no, let me just answer a couple of questions. Putting broccoli on a tortilla with butter is, no, you can't do that. Sodas, sugars, all the things that we are very commonly eating, what we're doing is giving those things up, as in the book of Daniel, where we give those things up, it helps our body. You know, by tomorrow or the next day, depending on how you eat, you may have some headaches, you may have some sweats. That's all the poison in your body being drained out. Don't panic. You're not dying. But what we do is we allow ourselves to say, okay, I believe that on the other side of this 21 days is something very important. And what I'm going to do, Lord, in the desert that I'm in now, I'm going to bring you something. Now, some people will say, well, I can't fast. You can fast something. One of my children said, Dad, I really want to do the fast. So I said, okay, well, let's don't get, what can for sure you do? He said, you know what I can do? I can give up TV and video games. Now, to me, that doesn't mean anything, but to him, it does. So, okay, then let's start there. Whatever you're doing, bring God something these next 3 weeks. Don't keep bringing God requests without bringing him anything, expecting him to get you out of a desert that you probably put yourself in. Why we fast is we align ourselves. We bring something to God. Now look at the order of this. Jesus took it, and what is the next thing that he did? Do you remember? He blessed it. See, he can't bless it if he doesn't have it. And if you have it, it's cursed. I'm not going to talk about the tithe this week. Maybe I'll do it next week. But that's what Jesus says about the tithe. You either give it or you steal it. Man, this. Remember Mark and Luke. Remember, you either give it or you steal it. So this is the thing with what God does with your life and with the blessings. You're either holding it or you're giving it. And if you're holding it, it's cursed. If you're holding it, it's gravely inadequate. If you're trying desperately, the thing about the desert is it has holds on you. It has hands, and it grips you. Can you fast secular music for 21 days? Come on, please, more than Sister Trudy, say amen. Secular music, worldly music, you know, all that stuff that you shouldn't have and be listening to anyway. Can you fast that for 21 days? Come on, more than 8 people. All right, what I'm getting at is, you see, what we're doing is we're saying, okay, I'm going to remove myself from things that are keeping me in the desert, and I'm going to give these things to God. All those things are great, but this is where the Lord is. I can't bless anything that you still have. And if you still have the will to choose what you obey and don't obey, if you still have the will to choose, well, I'm going to go to church, well, I don't really feel like it. I think my pancreas is acting up again. If you have the will to say, well, you know, I don't really feel like being married anymore. I don't really feel like giving anymore. I don't really feel like being involved in ministry anymore. If you're holding that, then you expect your desert to continue to increase, to grow. And you're there's so many symbols and signs of it. And what God wants to do is bring you and me into abundance. Somebody say amen. And the thing is this. Look at the person next to you and say this with all honesty. I've been wandering around long enough. I've been in desert relationships. Somebody say amen. I've been in desert finances. Somebody say amen. I've been in a desert where I've been praying and praying and nothing seems to be happening. I know what that is. I'm ready to transition into the blessings that God has for me, and he has for my family, and he has for this church. Give it to the Lord. And this is what God does. This is what God does. Jesus said he blessed it and he gave it to the individuals and they broke it and then they handed it out. Jesus didn't hand it out. They did. And the principle is, remember, they were excited about all the things that they did. You are going to do things, but remember, without me, you can't do anything. So why don't you, with me, see what you can do? with me, let me show you how I can fix things and change things and do miracles and things. Let me show you what I can do. Are you old enough to feel like you've wasted time in your life? Talking with individuals, I'll hear a young lady or a young man say, I was with him or with her for so many years. It was all a waste of time. Are you old enough to realize that some of the rebellion and disobedience and whatever you were trying and looking for and holding on to was nothing but a waste of time? Have you had experiences that in a desert, look, everybody look at me, you made massive mistakes. You hurt the people that were closest to you. And anytime you think back to that time in your life, it's like putting a sword right in the middle of your heart. Say this word with me, brokenness. Jesus loves to minister out of brokenness. As a matter of fact, without brokenness, nothing can be multiplied. First, it has to be given to the Lord to be blessed, but we don't need it blessed. We need it multiplied. The people are going to appreciate you saying a couple quick words of blessing over the thing, but it's not multiplied until it's broken. And if I can put this to you, as you walk out of the desert, somehow, some way, what the Lord does is say, you know what? That time that you spent there, I'm going to not just turn it around, but I'm going to turn it around for your good. I thought I heard the Lord say, all things work together for good for those who are the called according to my purposes. Even the things that you think and you know were so broken in your life, when they are given to God, God can work through that brokenness specifically and begin to minister to other individuals. People just don't understand. You know how they will understand? When someone like you says, I know what it's like to live a life of a hypocrite. I know what it's like to live a life of an adulteress. I know what it's like to be a liar and hate yourself, but I also know what it is to give that brokenness to the Lord, Him fix me up and put me on the right path and bring me out of the desert. I know what it looks like to be broken. I know what it looks like to be blessed. Isaiah chapter 43, verse 18 and 19, you don't have to go there, write it down. The Lord says this, and can I end with this in a prophetic way? Because I think that Jesus was remembering this scripture as these things were going on, and I'm going to prove it. He said, remember ye not the former things. Oh, what a promise right there. Don't remember the way it was, James. You know what, Daryl? Forget about the things that you failed in the past. You know what? Don't continue to remember that, because you know what? I'm bringing you out of the desert. I know that you've been broken, but look, pay attention. The Lord says, remember ye not the former things. Behold, I do a new thing. I'm going to bring, the scripture says, streams into the wilderness and rivers of water into the desert. And when rivers of water come into a desert, the desert ain't a desert no more. Somebody say amen. When God begins to bring provision into your life, it's not that the thing changes from overnight. What it does is I'm going to transform the very place that you think is desolate into a place of favor and grace by what I do, not what you do. All more people need to clap than that. Jesus said this when he looked at the people. Remember, he didn't say it, but the scripture says that the disciples heard him, so they wrote down that he had compassion upon the people, right, like a shepherd has over his sheep. That they were like sheep wandering without a shepherd. Listen to me, sheep wander into the desert. That's the analogy there. Sheep are not like cows. Cows are not the smartest animals in the world. But at least they're smart enough to keep eating grass in the field that they're at. That's not a sheep. A sheep will eat grass and keep doing. And then what they'll do is one of them will decide, you know, what's one on the other side of the highway? I don't know. Let's go look. And they'll all fall off a cliff because they're dumb. Listen, and sheep were part of nomadic people. That's why people hated shepherds. Follow me here. But there was a guy in the scripture, I wonder if Jesus remembered this, named David, who wrote a song, Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Verse 2. He makes me lie down and he leads me into the green pastures. Esther, follow me here. We got no food. We've given you our best. You've brought us to this desert. We're giving people out of our brokenness. And Jesus says, turn around. Turn around. What do you mean, turn around? Have the people sit on the green grass. What? Wait a minute here. Hold on a second here. Somehow, in one verse, we went from a desert place to have the people sit down on the green grass. Wait a minute here. Hold on a second here. Something has not just been changed. Something has been transformed. That the very place where we were brought, it didn't look like a place of rest. It didn't look like a place of blessing. It didn't look like it would ever be over. It didn't look like I'd ever get out of this desert. But when I gave what I had to the Lord, when I let him minister through my brokenness, turn around, he says, I'm still the shepherd that leads his people. Don't you think for a second that I would bring my people to a desert place. Don't you think for one minute I would bring my people to a place of desolation. Turn around, because when I'm here, the grass grows. When I'm here, everything is blessed. I still lead my people by the green pastures. Turn around. Your desert is blooming right now. Turn around. Your desert is increasing right now. That deserves a better hand than that. Give the Lord a shout in his house today. What happened with the people and what happened afterwards is not the message today. The message is not the food for the thousands. It's the teachings to the small group. I believe that maybe 2016 was a challenge for you. I believe that some of you, the last few years, have been one desert experience after another. Yeah. What I'm saying to you is this. Get ready for a fast. Give the Lord 21 days. Put into your heart and give to him. Lord, I'm going to give you, those of you who are here and, you know, it's difficult for you to get two or three Sundays together, just listen to me, no condemnation. Today, why don't you say, Lord, you know what? I'm going to give you the first 8 weeks of the year. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it, Father. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. Lord, I'm going to give you opportunity to work in me. Those of you that are here and can't seem to get out of the same routine, what I want to remind you is it may look like a desert. But the grass is blooming. It may look like a desert, but grass is going to bloom. And you might, and I believe we are, right at the place where God is going to begin to do something. God is going to begin to do something.
If he's still the God that brings us to still waters and green pastures, he's still the God that can do things in your life. Father, we love you and we bless you. We thank you and we praise you. Lord, we exalt you. You are the God that delivers us from the desert. Deliver us from these deserts. And let us begin to see in our marriages, in our spiritual lives, in our hunger for you, the grass begin to grow once again. Father God, I just rebuke everything, every fear, every anxiety that's attached itself to individuals that have stayed in a desert place too long. Father, I pray right now you begin to prosper, you begin to move. Do something in this church, oh God. Do something with us. Father, we don't want to hear what you're doing somewhere else. We want to experience it here, Father. Lord, without you, we can do nothing. We give it to you right now, and we bless you, and we praise you, and we exalt you. Thank you, Father. If you're here, and you've never asked the Lord Jesus Christ into your heart, I want you, everyone in this place, just bow your heads very quickly. If you've never asked the Lord into your heart, just lift your hand. All I want to do is pray for you. If that's you, you say, you know what? I've never asked the Lord into my heart. Just lift your hand up. Just lift your hand up. If you guys could just stand where you're at, those of you who are raising your, just stand. That's all. That's all we're going to do. Just stand up to your feet. Stand up to your feet very quickly. If we could have some ladies go around these individuals and pray very quickly. Very quickly, if we could have some individuals go over there and just pray real quick for these individuals that are standing. Let's believe God for great things. I want you guys just to lift up your hands. Just lift up your hands. Just like this. Just like you're receiving something. And let's pray. I want you to pray this prayer with me if you're standing. Say, Dear Jesus, come into my life. Forgive me of my sins. I give my life to you. Take me out of this desert. I can't do it by myself. Give me your strength and your grace. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen and amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Amen. Before we let them go, make sure we get their information. Let's everybody stand up. We're going to be dismissed. Let's everybody stand to our feet. We're going to be dismissed. Look at the person next to you and tell them, the green grass is growing. They may not believe you, but it's all right. You know, we've had a mild winter up until the last couple of days, and I was getting this message ready this week, and I looked at my yard. My yard's still as green as it was, you know, when I was watering it every day. Yours may be too, but the point is this. The world can be having scarcity, but there's always blessing in God's house. Amen. Lift up our hands. Lift up our hands very quickly. Let's pray. Right now, Father, we just thank you so much. I just declare, Lord God, your blessing and your favor over each individual in this place. I pray, Lord God, that you speak to each person and allow them, oh God, allow them to give you something. Father God, we just speak to each person right now, and we just declare, Lord God, right now, Father, we give you that thing that's going to get us out of the desert. And Lord, whatever you do, we want to be submissive to you. Lord, the brokenness that we found through our own disobedience and our own traveling, Lord, use it for our good. Right now, you're going to use even the worst decisions that we've made are going to come back to bless us because you bless brokenness. And Lord, let us see this week. Let us see this week, God. Every hand raised. Lord, let us see this week the grass begin to grow in our desert place. In Jesus' name, amen and amen and amen. Give three people a hug around their neck and tell them that you love them.